Welcome to Chapter 7 of our course on Communication Acoustics. My name is Stefan Weinzierl. I am head of the Audio Communication Group at TU Berlin and will guide you through some principles and techniques of sound recording and reproduction. In the first part of this lecture, we will have a look at the psychoacoustic principles of stereophony. When I say stereophony, I mean simple two-channel systems like the one you probably use at the moment, up to massive multi-channel systems with loudspeakers all around the listener and even at different elevations maybe, like the one you see here. As a definition of stereophony, I can give you a simple and a complex version. The simple definition would say that you need as many channels as you have loudspeakers. The more complicated would say that stereophony is a technique of audio transmission where the spatial characteristics of sound sources are encoded as inter-channel signal differences and where the sources are reproduced as phantom sources between pairs of loudspeakers. So the first definition helps to distinguish stereophony from sound field synthesis, where a rendering algorithm at the side of the receiver distributes the signals to a loudspeaker array. The second definition denotes the psychoacoustical mode of operation with the generation of so-called phantom sources as a result of interchannel signal differences. Let's have a closer look at these phantom sources and see how they are different from natural sound sources. If we recapitulate what you have learned about sound localization in Chapter 3 of this series, you have seen that we localize sound sources mainly by analyzing the interaural differences. For example, with the sound source at my left, at 90 degrees horizontally and 0 degrees vertically, the sound, of course, arrives earlier and louder at my left ear, and later and softer at my right ear. The exact values for this interaural differences can be extracted from the impulse response and the transfer function corresponding to this angle of incidence. The so-called head-related impulse responses, which you see at the right, or the head-related transfer functions, HRTFs, at the left. Both can be converted into each other by Fourier transformation. There you can now read off the interaural time difference and the interaural level difference, the latter one strongly depending on frequency. An additional cue, which for example helps to distinguish different elevations with the same ITD and ILD, comes from the spectral shape of the HRTF. If we compare the HRTFs of two sources both in front of me at different elevations, and this time only the left ears, you see that these are quite similar in time and level, but different in their spectral shape. So, spectral properties are an additional cue in localization. If we ask how accurately we can localize, we could use the so-called minimum audible angle as an indicator. This has been determined with a setup like this, where an array of closely spaced loudspeakers was used, and the subjects had to identify which of these loudspeakers was playing. The array was gradually turned from horizontal to vertical, and if you look at the results on the right side, you can see that the subjects were able to discriminate source locations by about 1 degree if the loudspeakers were oriented in horizontal direction, and that the resolution dropped to 3 to 4 degrees when the sources were separated in vertical direction. As a stimulus, clicks were used as a signal with both temporal and broadband spectral information. So we can summarize that the localization of natural sound sources relies on interaural time and level differences for sound sources in the horizontal plane, that it relies on spectral cues for sound sources separated vertically, and that localization works with a precision of between 1 degree and 3 to 4 degrees for horizontal and vertically spaced sources measured with broadband audio content. If we now compare natural listening with stereo listening over two loudspeakers, and let's for the moment ignore the center loudspeaker in this picture. One could think that the two loudspeakers just have to convey the same signal differences that we have between our ears in order to activate some kind of natural listening. But this is, of course, not true for several reasons. If we look at the signal path, we see that in addition to differences that may be present already in the two channels, the signals go through the binaural transfer path for a second time, now including the acoustics of the studio. And second, the signal of the left loudspeaker not only arrives at the left ear, but also, with a little delay, at the right ear. So we have a crosstalk of two signals at each ear, and it is not straightforward to predict what happens perceptually. I have mentioned this difference between natural listening and stereo listening because you can encounter this misunderstanding quite often in audio-related discussions. For example, when people recommend to use two microphones at ear distance to produce a natural recording. What happens when two loudspeakers play the same signal with time or level difference has been investigated already in the 1940s and 50s with the advent of the first stereo recordings. The result is a so-called phantom source, which is located somewhere between the two loudspeakers. If there is no time and level difference, it appears in the center. And if the level difference, for example, is 0.2 milliseconds, it appears at about 30% of the distance to the loudspeaker ahead in time. The stereophonic localization curves are slightly different if you measure them with speech, with music, or with artificial signals, as it has been done by the authors which are cited here. If you average them, you get something like this, an average localization curve. And now, let's see whether this really works and make a little listening test. Make sure that you listen with loudspeakers and that you sit in the center between the two speakers in the so-called sweet spot. You will hear pulsed pink noise, which is a quite popular signal for localization tests because it contains both temporal and broadband spectral cues. I will first play identical signals over both channels, and then stereo pairs with a level difference, each time increasing by 3 dB, what you can read off at the right side. Check out whether you localize the pulses at the expected position according to the localization curve at the right. So we start with a 0 dB level difference. We continue with 3 dB level difference, and so on. Now, with the advent of multi-channel stereo, such as the 5 channels shown here and often used in combination with video, we are interested whether we can produce phantom sources also with loudspeakers at the sides or behind. Between left and center, we get a similar picture as with left and right, with level differences of about 16 dB and time differences of between 1 and 1.5 milliseconds required to bring phantom sources from one loudspeaker to the other. When you look at the error bars showing the distribution of values over different subjects as interquartile ranges, you can see that level differences tend to produce a more stable localization than time difference. How does it work with loudspeakers at the sides? Here you see a quite non-linear curve. For a gradual transition, the curve should look like the dashed curve that you see here. Instead, the localization jumps from front to back within only some decibels of level difference and with large inter-individual differences, as you can see at the arrow bars. It is even worse with time differences, where you get a quite erratic behavior with a very unstable localization. And that is why lateral loudspeakers are usually not used to produce phantom sources. Some recent multi-channel systems not only use loudspeakers at one elevation, but at different heights to extend the sound image towards the vertical dimension. And consequently, we are also interested to what extent stereophony works in the vertical direction. Remember the slide with the minimum audible angles, where we saw that vertical localization is not as accurate in general, even with real sound sources. How it works with stereophony was investigated in this experiment. Two loudspeakers with a 30-degree angle in between were fed with band-limited and broadband pink noise. The upper one delayed with respect to the lower one by different time delays between 0 and 10 milliseconds. So with a perfect localization, you would expect that the lower and the upper loudspeakers, played here, are correctly identified when they play alone, and that you get a gradual transition from top to down with increasing time delay, as you can see here. However, nothing like this happens. We can rather see a quite erratic random behavior. For an explanation, remember that for vertical localization, we have to rely on spectral cues rather than time or level differences. And here, the comb filter that results from the interference of the delayed signals seems to produce certain peaks and dips in the spectral shape that more or less randomly coincide with the spectral cues corresponding to a certain elevation. Another interesting phenomenon, however, can be observed, which has been confirmed by several other investigations. And this is the fact that we tend to localize low-frequency sounds at the bottom, while we tend to localize high-frequency sounds at higher elevations. See how the different octave bands of band-limited noise are localized increasingly higher with increasing frequency. This phenomenon was termed pitch height effect, and it is difficult to explain this on a strictly psychophysical basis. If level differences are used rather than time differences, a slightly better behavior and a better defined transition can be seen in the vertical direction, however, again with large inter-individual differences. Thus, also vertical loudspeaker pairs are not very reliable in producing phantom sources. And if we summarize the first part of this lecture, we have seen that the localization of phantom sources can be generated by inter-channel time and inter-channel level differences between pairs of loudspeakers, that this works well for loudspeakers in front, but can hardly be controlled for lateral sources. Neither can it be controlled for vertical sources, although a little better with level differences than with time differences, and that the localization of phantom sources is generally less precise than for real sources and leads to an image with increased source width. What we have not answered so far is the question why we hear phantom sources at all. and why we localize them at a more or less defined position. Well, for an answer to this question, we have to consider our model of the auditory processing a little closer. This model includes a peripheral stage, where sound goes through the outer, the middle, and the inner ear. It includes a binaural stage, where the two signals are brought together and compared. And it includes a central process, where decisions are made. For example, where I decide to localize a sound. Now, when we feed a computational model of these processes with a stereophonic signal, like it was done in this study, and compare the sensory output with a natural sound source, we see that a stereo signal with a phantom source at 20 degrees has maximal similarity with a natural sound source at 20 degrees, although the result is slightly different for different frequency bands. So what we assume is that we use our experience with natural sound sources as a kind of template and choose the direction which has maximal similarity with the stereo signal. The fact that the result is not completely unambiguous over different frequencies is assumed to be the reason for the larger uncertainties and a somehow blurred extended image compared to a natural sound source. We can summarize that the perception of phantom sources is the result of a perceptual fusion of sound sources with sufficient similarity, and that the localization is the result of a pattern matching process with natural sources used as a template for the decision stage in the auditory processing chain. And now that we know the psychoacoustic basis of stereophony, we are well prepared to have a look at the techniques of stereophonic recording and reproduction in the second part of this lecture.